Hello everyone, my name is Ma'am Carla Marie Marquez and I'll be the voice of today's lesson. So today we are going to talk about Renaissance magic and technology. So after me would be Sir Rex V. Azucena Jr. and right up to the next slide, I will turn my camera off so that we can all focus on the presentation. Ancient Greeks believed that there were four elements that everything was made up of. Earth, water, air, and fire. This theory was suggested around 450 BC and it was later supported and added to by Aristotle. Aristotle also suggests that there was a fifth element, ether, because it seemed strange that the stars would be made out of earthly materials or earthly elements. He would be surprised to learn, actually, that they are in fact made up of elements found on Earth. For us, in the modern times, you already know that they are so hot that they could be said to be on fire all the time. During the time of Hippocrates, the concept of body humors developed. Prior to this time, illnesses were attributed to one cause, which is evil spirits with varying symptoms. The four humors or fluid substances of the body were blood, yellow bile, black bile, and phlegm. This theory was closely related to the theory of the four elements, earth, fire, water, and air. Earth was represented by black bile, fire by yellow bile, and water by phlegm. Were an amalgam or mixed na or blended of classical and Christian thought, and from what can be inferred from written sources, shaped the way that educated people experience and interpreted phenomena. What people who do not read or write books naman understood about nature is more difficult to tell, except that belief in magic, good and evil spirits, witchcraft, and forecasting or fortune telling was universal. The church might prefer that Christians seek their well-being through faith, the sacraments, and the intercession of Mary and the saints, but distinctions between acceptable and unacceptable belief in hidden powers were difficult to make or to maintain. Most clergy shared the common beliefs in occult forces and lent their authority to them. The collaboration of formal doctrine and popular belief had some of its terrible consequences during the Renaissance, such as pogroms against Jews and witch hunts, in which the church provided the doctrines of satanic conspiracy and the inquisitorial agents, and popular prejudice supplied the victims, predominantly women and marginal people. Renaissance natural magic. But what is natural magic? Natural magic daw is not some kind of demonic or spiritual magic, because it uses natural means in order to please the celestials. Para kumaga, we have a control over astrological or cosmic forces. So magic is extraordinary control of hidden forces or the occult powers. Magic is classified into three, which is the control over hidden powers of earthly things, celestial things, and spiritual things. For earthly things, it includes alchemy, which deals specifically with minerals and metals. For celestial things, it includes astrology, celestial. And lastly, for spiritual things, these includes control over angels and demons, which is highly symbolic. In the modern times, we can easily say that we do not believe, or most of us don't believe in magic anymore, or the superstitious. But during the Renaissance time, we all know Renaissance, it's where people went back to being scholarly and to the art, do you think with their intellect, did they accepted magic? Well, actually, there are two answers for this. Those that see positive, those that accepted magic, sees magic as a supposition that humans can control cosmic forces, where it fits the Renaissance higher estimation of human capacities. In contrast sa medieval humility, wherein during the medieval times, wala, human beings are mediocre. For negative naman, of course, being in the Renaissance era, it's still a very Christian era, and magic saw it as an attempt to put yourself in God's place or a subversion of God's will for the world. Because as you can see, if you use magic for your own will or for your own benefit, you are just like playing God, because you use magic to cause events that are extraordinary or fantastic, and it changes the natural course of events that God ordained. The personalities. First is Marsilio Ficino, which is a translator. He translated the Hermetic Corpus as instructed by Cosimo Medici. Hermetic means secret, esoteric, or occult, or hidden. So the Hermetic principles refer to knowledge of the laws by which the universe conducts business, as passed down by the teachings of Hermes, the Greek god. Anyone who understands these laws or principles can cause them to master the planes of existence. So his writing along with the Hermetic Corpus all share certain ideas that we call the Neoplatonic. Thinkers articulate somewhat different versions of these ideas, but a common framework can be constructed. That's why you saw earlier that we have a levels of reality, because the basic picture of multi-layered levels of reality with forms and or souls is from the Neoplatonicism. So these different layers are the divine mind or the God, the spirit of the world, humans, and terrestrial matter, wherein the divine mind or God contains the forms or ideas, and the world soul or the spirit of the world contains one seminal reason corresponding to each form. These seminal reasons are often emitted from planets and stars. Let's go to Ficino's astrological magic and medicine. So astrology and medicine. Ficino puts his Neoplatonic framework to therapeutic use. The basic idea is to capture whichever celestial influences would be most beneficial to a given patient. This is done by luring or attempting to lure the particular seminal reason down with a bait. So, for example, if you want to be cheerful, you want to have a happy disposition, you wear anything, or you wear something that resembles the sun. If you want to be wealthy, you wear something gold, something like that. So Renaissance magus thinks that celestial influences are always bombarding the earth, but we have to be wearing and ingesting the right things and thinking the right things in order to amplify the signal from the celestial body enough to change our health or to change our well-being. So, para sila, like attracts like. Like, in a sense nga, we have here, you have to be one with nature. So, stones and metals, that's why may mga amulet or what we call in the Philippines agimat, and then if you want to have peace of mind, you surround yourself with plants and other organic matter, vapor, smells, sounds, words and songs, acts of imagination, acts of reason, and acts of contemplation. But We are reminded that our minds, Tao, and our souls are stronger attractors of celestial influences than these material things. It doesn't matter if you have all these things as your lucky charm, but if you think or if your soul is the opposite way, it thinks melancholically, you are still going to be melancholic. Is astrological magic compatible with Christian doctrine? For Ficino, he answered this as, this astrological magic is presented to help and heal the sick, so maybe no. And then, he also suggests that he claims that he is not recommending magic, but only describing it. So, para kumbaga nag-play safe siya. Next is the magic presented Tao is not demonic or spiritual magic, but natural magic, because the aim of natural magic is to subject natural things to natural causes to be formed in a wonderful way, and to use natural things to obtain the services of the celestial. So mainly about using natural things. So that's why it's called natural magic. And actually, for Ficino, a magus is really like a farmer. So as a farmer cultivates, when we say magus, it's a magician or a person who uses magic. So as a farmer cultivates plants in soil, the magus cultivates the world by adjusting the lower parts of the world to the upper parts of the world. This is an answer to the critic nga if magic is compatible with the Christian doctrine, because who says that a magician is subverting God's plan for the world if the magician is subverting God's plan no more than the farmer? Agrippa, let's go to Agrippa. He accepts the basic Neoplatonic framework sketched above with Ficino. God has the forms in his mind, that's why he is at the very top. And he created angelical and celestial secondary causes or beings that he called the intelligences. And God gives the seal of his ideas to the intelligences. And then the intelligences then use the heavens and the stars as instrument to send these copies of the forms down to humans on the earth. In exactly the way our souls or intellects control our bodies and intelligences, the celestial souls or who controls the body or the matter of the universe. So just as my mind sends commands to my body in order for our mind to achieve its aims, so too do the intelligences, celestial souls, use the stars to achieve their ends. Agrippa says that quintessence, may term siyang laging coin, which is quintessence, or it is just like Aristotle's fifth element, the ether, is what conveys the intelligence's power to material stuffs. The spirit is contained in the rays of the stars. So that's why ang iyang idea is that whatever is just like in the first niya medical astrology and medicine ni Ficino, whatever captures the light or the sun rays the most, you use that in order to heal yourself, because whatever spirit is contained in that rays or the rays of the stars, you should consume that, you should use that, because that's natural magic. What are occult qualities? There are two kinds of properties or qualities, which is occult and manifest. Occult is hidden, manifest is observable. Examples of occult qualities includes magnetism, static electricity. So we can see why the soccer ball moves away from the foot after we kick it. But we do not see why the positively charged ends of two magnets move away from each other, or why our hair rise up when we get near a blanket that is charged with static electricity. So a third example is gravity. We see its effects just as the static electricity and magnets, but we do not see gravity itself. So occult qualities come ultimately from the forms via the celestial souls sending out the seminal reasons in stars' rays. So in some sense, the magnetized iron ore has a different soul than a plain vanilla iron ore. Biskan pareho lang sila itsura. And that difference in soul explains why one has an occult property of magnetism and the other doesn't. Agrippa goes on to suggest that everything on the earth, since it is all exposed to celestial influences via stars' rays, has a bit of soul in it. Agrippa suggests that for medicine and technology, we should use things that have captured and stored up a large amount of a single kind of soul, since that we will have the most, it will have the most of that particular form or idea reflected in it. Agrippa asks, could we perhaps extract the spirit from stones, minerals, and herbs? And that's why the idea of alchemy is born, because the very purpose of alchemy is to try to extract the spirit from stones, minerals, and herbs, and whatever material that can do that is called the philosopher's stone. To Paracelsus. Paracelsus embraced some hermetic, mystical, Neoplatonist ideas, and he believed that metals are literally born in the earth, like literally when the proper seminal reason or astral seed meets and combines with the right material matrix. And the metal then undergoes a period of gestation, just like an animal embryo. So Paracelsus was skeptical with the four element theory of the ancients, because the Genesis thou never mentioned God creating fire, so it must not be a basic element. And he forwarded his own set of material principles for minerals and metals. So mayroon siya isang sulfur, mercury, and salt. Ang mga basic material principles for minerals and metals. Sulfur, which is active and burning. Mercury, passive and liquid. And salt, stable, solid, and inert. Whereas Hippocratic Galenic cures used organic matter, primarily plants, Paracelsus would prescribe metals and minerals. So, sa iyang mga pasyente. So, kung may sakit ka and then nagkato ka kay Paracelsus, gaanya ka sang mercury, antimony, and lead as bulong. Paracelsus rejected the Greek notion of disease as an overall holistic imbalance of humors in the body. Rather, he thought that most diseases were localized to a particular organ. He thought of each organ as a little alchemist, distilling out the impurities of the materials presented to it. So somehow may point siya. Example ko no is the stomach separates the nutrients from the waste. Also, Paracelsus rejected the health as balance viewpoint on the grounds of his belief that like cures like under the right circumstances. That is, instead of prescribing something cold for a patient with a fever, because sa Hippocratic pa nga times, when a person has fever, gaan siya dapat something cold para mabalance. Yeah, instead of prescribing something cold for a patient with fever, Paracelsus would prescribe something hot. But this hot thing would have to be subjected to chemical purification and distillation procedures in order to remove harmful impurities. And during this time, a pointless profession was born, which is witch hunting. So the next slide, we have here a video by BuzzFeed about witch trials. So it's just a video clip, and I will provide a link for the full video if you want to watch more of it.
In March 1644, a man by the name of Matthew Hopkins claimed to have encountered six witches in Manningtree, who allegedly tried to kill him. Hopkins would become a notorious witch hunter who was responsible for upwards of 300 witches being tried and executed between 1644 and 1647. He traveled to Essex, Suffolk, Norfolk, Huntingdon, and Greater East Anglia to solicit his services of rooting out witches, forcing them to confess, and then having them hanged. All this for a generous fee, of course, which was sometimes paid for by the local magistrates, amounting to a month's worth of wages. Hopkins, along with his two assistants, would set out to eradicate witches within the community. His way of identifying a witch was much along the lines of the general consensus, which, for the most part, was torturous, along with his own special methods. He would prick a skin deformity, he considered essentially a feeding nipple for imps. If the person did not sense the prick, they were a witch. With a hefty price tag on the heads of witches, conniving and falsified ways of making these claims and prosecutions would also emerge. It was said that Hopkins had fashioned a retractable pin in order to successfully prosecute a witch and collect his handsome reward. Another one of his methods was binding people and throwing them into water, and if they floated, it was an indication that they were a witch, believing that the water was repelling them due to the suspect having denied baptism. Ironically, rumors have since circulated that Hopkins' untimely death in 1647 was because he himself was accused of being a witch and then failed to pass his own tests. In reality, it is more likely that he died of tuberculosis or another illness. That same year prior to his death, Hopkins published a book called The Discovery of Witches. Another notable witch hunter during this craze was an unnamed Scottish man known only as the Bellman, who was hired by the Puritan magistrates of Newcastle around 1650. This purge, which followed, was known as the Newcastle Trials. Claiming that he could identify a witch by her appearance alone, the Bellman is believed to be responsible for the execution of over 120 women. Upon his arrival, he reportedly asked the villagers to bring in any complaint against any woman for a witch, and that they should be sent for and tried by the person appointed. Like Hopkins, the Bellman also used the skin-pricking method as a means for ruling out the innocent versus the guilty. If they bled, they passed the test. If not, a guilty verdict was closing in. He reportedly made anywhere between 20 and 30 shillings for a successful prosecution, which, at the time, was roughly 10 times the average daily salary. Again, a very tempting reward for those seeking to get rich by any means necessary.
So that's it. Here is the link if you want to watch the full video of that. Okay, next. And now let's go to Renaissance technology. Actually, there are a lot of technology that was developed during the Renaissance period. But I have here four main people, and you'll know later why I chose these four. Okay, so let's proceed with of Galileo's inventions, and let's go through them one by one. First is the telescope. He didn't invent the first telescope, but telescopes before his invention could only magnify objects by three times using two lenses and shows the image upside down. Galileo constructed his own telescope in 1609, and he added a third lens. Hence, his telescope magnified items by eight times and showed them right side up. Over the following years, Galileo built several telescopes, including one that would magnify items by a factor of 30. Next is the celestome. It is a device invented by Galileo Galilei to observe Jupiter's moons and with the purpose of finding longitude on Earth. It took the form of a piece of headgear with a telescope, taking the place of an eye hole. Next is Galileo's micrometer. This device was fitted on the telescope and could slide along the body tube, and Galileo observed the Jupiter system through the telescope with one eye while the other eye watched the micrometer lit by a lantern. He then set the micrometer distance to make the interval between two divisions of the graduated scale coincide with the planet's apparent diameter. So that's how he viewed the Jupiter's system. Next is Galileo's compass. Throughout the Renaissance, many attempts were made to develop a universal instrument that could be used to perform arithmetical calculation and geometric operations easily. This need was felt especially in the military field, where technology of firearms called for increasingly precise mathematical knowledge. To satisfy these requisites, the first proportional compasses were developed in the second half of the 16th century because there was a need nga mag-produce some precise instrument or universal instrument. That's why Galileo made this compass. Galileo's escapement. So, this was the earliest design for a pendulum clock. Okay, so during this time, he was already blind by then, so he described the design or the idea to his son. So, ang iyang son ang nag-sketch sang plan. First is as you can see, the escapement can be found at sa top sang pendulum or grandfather clock. Alright. And now let's go to Renaissance technology. Actually, for Nicholas Copernicus, I will only give one of his invention or discoveries. So I have here the heliocentric model devised by Nicholas Copernicus. The Greek word helios means sun, and of course it means that sun as being the center of the solar system and not Earth. So that's why it's a big topic, because ginpagwa ni Nicholas Copernicus ang idea nga ni during the time wherein the Earth was, or yeah, majority of the people on Earth believe that the Earth is the center of the universe, which is a contradiction siya sa famous belief. When we say Copernicus versus the Church, this is what we imagine. So I have
Eureka! We aren't at the center of the universe. The Earth revolves around the sun!
Copernicus bravely published his theory, despite the inevitable wrath he'd faced from the Catholic Church.
Copernicus, we're here to burn you alive! I shall not be silenced!
But actually, this is what happened.
Copernicus, how's your work going, you old church bureaucrat?
Finished early, boss! In fact, I've been working on my astronomy. I have this new theory I'm calling...
Don't care!
Because actually, Nicholas Copernicus works for the church. And it's not that the church is okay with idea. It's just that damo sila may gina ginapanumdum during that time that is wala nila ginaprioritize kung ano man ang ginasulat ni Copernicus. It's not blasphemous before, but it's the Protestant church that had been in quarrel with Copernicus' idea. So that's why napilitan si Catholic Church nga sa pakon ang idea or ang ang idea ni Copernicus about the heliocentric universe, because gakadulaan na sila worshippers, gakadto na sa Protestant Church. Is Leonardo da Vinci, and as you can see here, we have three of his ideas, is his sketches, and the first one is the winged fly machine, or this is a concept now of an airplane. Leonardo is widely considered the first engineer to be credited with designs for a man-powered flight. The discoveries made during countless dissections of birds and bat wings were evident in the design for the ornithopter, because he bases his design on birds, and a device that flies by flapping winged appendages. Is another flying machine, the helical aerial screw, conceived by Leonardo in 1493, consisted of a spinning linen screw designed to compress air to induce flight, a mechanism similar to that employed in contemporary helicopters. So, Leonardo's design is widely credited as the vertical flight machine. Next is the barrel cannon. Leonardo devised a multi-barrel cannon that could be rotated to fire a line of cannons while another was being reloaded. It is a primitive ancestor of the modern-day machine gun. Let's go to Johann Gutenberg. Johann Gutenberg is the inventor of the printing press. So, I put him here sa kumbaga worthy of presentation, because without him, it's because of the printing press that we have an account or records of these Renaissance discoveries. Creation of the printing press turned out to be a big help in creating vernacular literature available to the wider public during that time, and to us pagani in a different era na. So metal alloys and molds were utilized in the first type of printing press created by Gutenberg. So that is why it's called a printing press, because this approach utilized by Gutenberg for prints was called letterpress printing. Kay literal na ginapress mo siya para ma-transfer mo ang words or ang print. So that's it for Renaissance magic and technology, and here are some of the books, two of which nga not in our references, main references that I've read for this topic, and I suggest you try to read this, most especially Little History of Science by William Bynum, because of these books, it helped me devise or present these ideas with you. And if you want to read about the Renaissance inventors, I have also listed names, but wala ko lang yung dala para hindi maging overcrowded or my own information overload. So Galileo Galilei already discussed, you can read more about them. Kailangan pa sang inventions nga wala na dala sa report. Leonardo da Vinci, he has lots of journals that contains his inventions and ideas. Nicholas Copernicus, Sophia Brahe, Johann Kepler, Isaac Newton, William Harvey, Johann Gutenberg,
Pascal, Sir Francis Bacon, and Andreas Vesalius.
So that's it for listening for the first part of our topic. We'll now proceed with the second part together with Mr. Rex Azucena.